Hello, everyone. Hello. Welcome to the George Bass Performing Space, Rice and Reason Theater and Africana Studies Department. My name is Tony Bogues. I'm the director of the Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice. I want to welcome you all this evening to the final event of the center. The Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice, some of you may know, particularly those who are alums, and some of you may have been around, was formed out of a set of recommendations made to the university, which emerged out of a report on slavery and justice, the relationship of Brown University to the Atlantic slave trade, and to and the relation of that trade to Rhode Island and the plantations. The center was one recommendation, and that center was formed in 2012. And ever since then, every commencement, we have attempted to do a series of events which highlight or foreground the questions of slavery and its legacy, or what we like to call its historical deposits in contemporary America, questions particularly of race and anti-black racism. And this is the last commencement event. We began Thursday night, and we had a whole set of things Friday, and we had a whole set of things as well today. I would like to begin in this my opening remarks by thanking somebody who made this possible. The center is a space that welcomes ideas. And as I thought about it this morning, we had about five events over the last couple of days. And with the exception of an external board meeting, which we had to do, which we did at lunchtime today, all the events that we had were actually events that were suggested to us by people who were associated with the center. And I am very happy for that, because what that means is that the center has now as a reputation or becomes a space that people feel that they can come to us and make a suggestion, and if we can fund it and put it together, we say yes. And so in that regard, I would like to thank Jordan T. Camp, the postgrad fellow who's at the Center for the Study of Race and Ethnicity and the Watson, who came to me one afternoon and suggested this particular project. Jordan's somewhere around there, I can't see very well, but thank you very much. This event is being streamed live, so we will speak in the microphones. Secondly, I want to remind you always of cell phones off, not on vibrate, but off. And then also just remind you that there are two exits right behind you. The event that you are about to see is one which we have spent, after Jordan spoke to us and we agreed, we have spent trying to think about how it could be put together. And what we came up with was a kind of mixed event, one in which there would be poetry, readings from a play called Liquid Plain, written by Naomi Campbell, and it's a play about slavery in Rhode Island, and then a discussion by historians and by persons who think about these questions about the play and about questions, I'm sure, of America and race today. So you're getting really a mixed product, beginning with a play, and then the readings from the play, beginning with a poem, then readings from the play, and then a formal discussion. And then hopefully when we have time, if we have time, I hope we have time, we can do a Q&A. Let me just say a few things about the persons who will appear in all these things, and also give thanks. We will listen to a poem composed by Evie Shockley. And Evie Shockley is the Heimark Heimark Artist-in-Residence at the Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice this year. We are very fortunate to have a donor and who has given us money to do Artist-in-Residence, and this year we chose Evie to do it, and she will begin the program. After her poem, we will then have a reading from the play, Liquid Plain, and the two readers would be Mr. Jeff Gill, who's from Providence and who is associated a lot with Rights and Reason Theater, and I thank him very much for almost at the last minute agreeing to do this. And then LisaGay Hamilton. And LisaGay Hamilton, some of you may or may not know, is a very important African-American film and stage and television actress, best known for her work or her role in the Practice, and for also her role in Beloved. And we are deeply, deeply honored that Ms. LisaGay Hamilton could take time out of her very busy schedule to be with us today. So thank you very much, Lisa. After that reading, we will then have a panel discussion. And Evie would be on the panel. Lisa would also, if she feels like it, will be on the panel. And the scholars on the panel, and it's an artificial distinction I don't like to make, but the scholars on the panel would be the distinguished professor of history from University of Pittsburgh, Marcus Rediker, who's no stranger to Brown, and from whose work on the slave ship, A Human Story, was the inspiration for this particular play, Liquid Plain, by Naomi Campbell. Then we will have Professor Robin as well, Professor Robin Kelley, who many of you would know of as a premier historian of African-American culture, life, and politics, and perhaps one of the most important historians of African-American life and culture and of his generation. Then also on it would be Jordan Camp, and I would just want to say, Jordan, as a postgraduate, but I don't know what you say when you have postgraduates who have produced two books coming out in 2 months. He has an edited volume, and he has a book on published by University of California Press on questions of police and the carceral state, in particularly looking at America. So that's how these are the individuals that will participate in this mixed event. I hope that you will find what we have done, what we have sought to do, productive, educational, not didactic, but educational, and also perhaps important, and something that may allow us to think about this question of slavery, but also, quite frankly, its deposits. So, thank you all very much for coming again, and without any further ado, can I ask Ms. Evie Shockley to please come here.
Good evening, can you hear me? No? Can you hear me now? Thank you. It is a tremendous honor to be here and in this company as artist in residence at the Center for the Study of Slavery and Social Justice. And I keep adding social justice into the title of the center because it should be there, right? But to be serving as artist in residence at the Center for Slavery, for the Study of Slavery and Justice. This week has been an amazing honor, and I am excited about the play that you all are going to see a scene from, and about sharing this poem that, like the play, touches on the subjects of the slave ship and slavery in Rhode Island in its own ways. I won't say too much by way of introduction, but a couple of things that it is important to note is that include the fact that I draw heavily on the one of the books that was also important for Naomi Wallace's play, that is Marcus Rediker's The Slave Ship, A Human History. I also draw on the report of the Brown University Steering Committee on Slavery and Justice. And you will hear some terms at times that I draw from 18th century language that I culled from both that book and from historical documents that are in the holdings of the John Carter Brown Library and the Rhode Island Historical Society. I would also say that there's one word that I'm drawing from a ship's log that is not an unusual word, but is spelled differently than we spell it, and it might help you as listeners to hear that. And it's spelled D-Y-E-D. And the last thing I'll say is that there are six sections in this poem that the sections are hinged by the lyrics or a song that my friends and I sang and played when I was growing up in Nashville. But it's a song that connects us to black girls in a wider geography in the black diaspora. So there are two epigraphs. The first is from The Slave Ship, A Human History. The wide-ranging, well-armed slave ship was a powerful sailing machine. It was also a factory and a prison. And in this combination lay its genius and its horror. Sailors not only worked in a global market, they produced for it, helping to create the commodity called slave to be sold in American plantation societies. That's Marcus Rediker. And from the report of the Brown University Steering Committee on Slavery and Justice, in 1764, the year that the College of Rhode Island, later Brown University, was founded, Essex Hopkins sailed to West Africa in command of a slave ship, a 100-ton brigantine called the Sally. The Sally was owned by Nicholas Brown and Company, a partnership of four brothers, Nicholas, John, Joseph, and Moses Brown. I'm dedicating this reading to Naomi Wallace. Black mechanics, or offshore manufacturing, avant la lettre. Like clockwork, they arrived, masts high on the horizon, resurrected trees rigged with taut rope branches and huge white windblown blooms. Oaks and pines, trees planted in West Africa's coastal waters by men whose hearts, it seemed, could not be moved. A self-replenishing forest of factories, slowly assembling the vital parts of the American agricultural industrial enterprise, the complex components that made the machine of transatlantic trade run. Strut Miss Sally, 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 strut Miss Sally all night long. Who has the facts on the factories? Who has the goods on the goods? What tale comes creaking from ship's logs, those shivering timbers drenched in blood, piss, rum, and sweat? What news does the platform bear of the bodies it has borne? Makeshift boards on which captives were made to shift and rock themselves raw to the ship's pitching, to huddle bent and curled between decks no more than 5 feet apart, stowed sideways in space as dark and airless as a drawer. The nail that holds the wood together can be, in an instant, the tool that picks the cuffs aloose. Ship that's true friend to no one, captain nor crew, investor nor insurer, and least of all, the witches, thieves, adulterers, warriors, farmers, and children packed tight in the coffin-sized cell of a new status, slave. Sally, 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 one Negro girl. A ship named Phyllis produced a girl named Phyllis. Why not a Sally from the Sally? A girl slave manufactured in accordance with best practices, made to swallow her allotment of foul water and her daily portion of yam or dab-a-dab against the fevers and flux, ripped or stolen from her parents' arms, but danced past the despair of the woman slave who hanged herself between decks. Perhaps pressed into service as one of the captain's favorites, or perhaps finding the die cast for a different process of molding. If this Sally, not left almost dead on the windward coast to compensate the linguister for 9 months' work traveling between tongues, not one of the 8 insurrectionists destroyed by crew fire, not one of those afterwards so dispirited they drowned or starved themselves, not one of the 20 who, after a 7 weeks crossing, died upon arrival in the West Indies. If this Sally set her Negro girl foot on Antiguan soil, she found perforce her place in the large machine that turned her handiwork into sugar, the sugar into rum, and so many gallons of rum in turn to Senegambian or Negro girls into 3 slaves, 2 men, and 1 woman. A miracle of modern industry, transatlantic transubstantiation. Here comes another one, just like the other one. One Sally, a girl who had been born Jolof, perhaps, or Gola, whose parents had named her Sifaye or Musu, who learned nakedness and orphanhood and revulsion from sailors in the sea. Another Sally, a Guineaman built maybe for non-human, not inhuman trade, a brigantine that became another Sally's brig. A rose is a rose is arrows. One John Brown digs in his well-heeled heels, stays in the slave trade in the frowning face of a Quaker brother. Another John Brown gives his life and loses his sons to the abolitionist cause, dies in a raid on the government's armory to arm the rebellious enslaved. One John Brown is not like another. And what's in a euphemism? The hungry ships were fueled by African inter-ethnic wars that just coincided with the sight of sails. Land-based piracy, raids, kidnapping, justified by grievances manufactured by the machine. Call it the Africa trade, if you prefer. Call its victims prisoners of war, or criminals conveniently convicted of social evils, sudden adulterers, inadvertent debtors, and witches as unwitting as Salem's. Or call them cargo. Call them any name you please as you count them, coming and going, going on board or over, coming together like welded metals. Many millions become many fewer. E pluribus negrum. Here comes another one all night long. The Sally's log accounts for the transformation in this way. August 1765, died, died, destroyed, died, died. September, ditto, died, died, etc., etc. Of the 196 Africans bought and brought aboard, 108 died Mande, Gola, Igbo, Fon, Iwe, Fanti, Ibao, and Kru. The rest died black, sooner or later, stewed and stained in the fluids of the Middle Passage. Think of our so-called Sally emerging from the hold on the shores of Antigua in very indifferent health, hand in hand with one woman slave or one boy ditto, taking wavering steps into fates unknown, uncertain, or worst of all, likely. Think of their fingers, tightly interlocked, enmeshed like the teeth of small cogs in a machine whose parts are sold separately. Strut, Miss Sally, 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 strut, Miss Sally, all day long. Strut, Miss Sally, we call on you to strut, Miss Phyllis, strut, Miss Mariah, Miss Harriet, Miss Frances Ellen, Miss Anna Julia, Miss Ida, Miss Bessie, Miss Zora, Miss Lou, Miss Jessie, Miss Josephine, Miss Gwendolyn, Miss Fanny Lou, Miss Paul, Miss Ella, Miss Nina, Miss Audrey, Miss Rosa, Miss Shirley, Miss Elizabeth, Miss Jane, Miss Ruby, Miss Lucille, Miss Paula, Miss Ruth. Doing what struts do, load-bearing, shock-absorbing, strengthening, resisting, restraining movement in some directions, allowing it in others. You are the byproduct of a process that does not know your names. You are our black mechanics, our working parts. So work it, Miss Tony, Miss Sonia, Miss Angela, Miss Brenda Marie, Miss Norbessie, Miss Carrie Mae, Miss Aisha, Miss Patrice. You strut like the ghosts in another machine whose time it is now to run.
Hello, can you hear me? So one John Brown is certainly not like another. So you have to give it up again for that. Great, Evie Shockley. Okay, so I'm here basically to give you some context for the scenes you're about to see. The Liquid Plain by Naomi Wallace is set in Bristol, Rhode Island. The first act takes place in 1791, the year of the beginning of the Haitian Revolution. 4 years after the U.S. Constitution had been ratified and the international slave trade was really at its height. The second and third acts take place in 1837, 3 decades after the abolition of the slave trade and 3 years after the abolition of slavery in the British Empire. The story begins with two lovers, Adjoa and Demby, fugitives from slavery surviving along Bristol's docks with plans to return to West Africa. As they await a ship captained by a former slave by the name of Liverpool Joe, they pull what they think is a corpse from the water in search of valuables. And as it turns out, the man, John Cranston, was alive but lost his memory. Demby and Adjoa temporarily employ Cranston, who eventually rapes Adjoa, threatening to turn them over to slave captors. As Cranston begins to regain his memory, we learn that he was a former crew member on the slave ship Polly, captained by James DeWolf. DeWolf had been indicted for murder after he bound an enslaved woman to a chair and threw her overboard. And Cranston had testified against DeWolf, and this is how he ended up in the water in the first place, left for dead. It was actually a botched attempt at retaliation. Now, the story of DeWolf and Cranston's testimony is in fact true. In fact, it was written beautifully by Marcus Rediker in The Slave Ship of Human History. Not surprisingly, DeWolf was acquitted of all charges, and DeWolf has a presence here in Rhode Island. Some of you may know that. DeWolf's victim, it turns out, was sister to Adjoa, who also bore witness to the murder. Hearing Cranston recount the story forced Adjoa to relive the trauma. Liverpool Joe shows up with the ship, and just as they were about to take off, with Cranston as part of the crew, Adjoa tells Demby that she is pregnant. Knowing that he could not have fathered the child, Demby stabs Adjoa and flees. They board the ship anyway, and the crew keeps her alive long enough for her to deliver her daughter, Bristol. So the daughter, named Bristol after the city, returns 46 years later, the period of the second and third act. So what we're gonna see are two scenes from, one scene from the second act and one scene from the third act. We'll hear some of Bristol's story in the performance that follows by LisaGay Hamilton, but it's important to realize that Bristol lived a life of struggle, both enslaved and free in the Caribbean and England. She knew her mother and aunt's story, and in 1837, she comes to Bristol with the intention of assassinating DeWolf, now a prominent senator and philanthropist, having built his wealth from slaving. Bristol also discovers that her putative father, Demby, is still alive, so she seeks him out. The first scene we'll see is Bristol meeting Demby for the first time, telling her story, and the second scene is Bristol's confrontation with DeWolf.
My name is Bristol Waters. I am a free woman. When I was born, I was so small that I fit in the palm of my uncle's hand. His hands were rough for working the sails, and they chafed my skin. My mother was dying on the deck of the vessel when we sailed. She had a hole in her breast, 3 fingers wide, and when the sun hit the crack of the wound, the crew could see the corner of her heart. They were afraid to see her living when she should be dead. But then a fish leapt on the starboard side of the vessel and landed on deck. The crew had never seen a fish so red before, as though filled up with blood. And my uncle, he snatched the fish, squeezed it over my mother's mouth, and its liquid poured into her and gave her blood. He then used the tiniest bones of this same fish, boiled clean, to suture shut her wound. And the crew, taking turns, chewed their beef to porridge and fed her like a bird would feed its chick. And she didn't die. She never woke again, but she did not die. We sailed for England short of crew, and we made the crossing. We provisioned our vessel at different ports. 3 days out Lisbon, my mother's waters broke, or something broke for it, poured fast out of her, and my uncle couldn't stop it. And as I was born, my mother died. The crew were happy to have saved me, but so sad to see my mother die. They said their hearts broke with such a crack that fish was started from the water spring beside the boat. This is where my uncle, Liverpool Joe, they called him, nicked me with his knife when he cut me from my mother's womb. My uncle's friend Balthazar nursed me on biscuits and gruel, and I did not die. Though as a child I was so thin, my uncle said that sometimes when I stood beside him, he couldn't see me. I never knew my mother. Her name was Adjoa.
mansion, an elegant study. A huge window overlooks the harbor. He stands gazing at the painting.
Et in Arcadia ego.
I too am in Arcadia. I've seen the original at the Louvre.
Paris has a copy. This is the original. On quiet loan for as long as I wish. Flawless. I could stare at it for hours. Et in Arcadia ego. Even in Arcadia there is death. The absolute clarity, the balance, the harmony of all its parts working as one aesthetic machine. Are not these the elements to shape a man? I can see the waters from this window. It always creates in me a yearning for voyage. John Cranston came by to warn me of your visit, though I had the sense it was less about protecting me than you. He still bears a grudge for having himself unsuccessfully drowned. I don't know if this grudge is because I wanted him dead or because I failed at the task. Welcome. I've been waiting for you for over 40 years. Well, someone like you. You're almost old. I expected a younger.
It's taken me a long time to get here.
May I assume that you've already visited the brewers, bakers, draymen, masons, caulkers, glaziers, block makers, riggers, joiners, rope walkers? Not to mention the butchers, blacksmiths, coopers, shipwrights, painters, carvers in this city. But we were in it together. I financed 88 voyages, transported...
Enslaved.
More than 10,000 Africans. I still own three of the finest plantations in Cuba. I've made all that has formed you. You hear about the chair. It's just one stupid slip of the tongue, and I've already been consigned to the dark end of this country's short history. Yes, I did say I regretted the loss of my chair when I threw her overboard.
Yes, when you threw her overboard.
More than a few good chairs were thrown overboard in those decades.
She was my family.
No, it's over. Slaving is illegal now.
But not slavery.
Mr. Cranston says you have a knife.
And I know how to use it. Et in Arcadia Argo. Vigorous. Sunburned. Hair thickened with the salt of the waves, excellent at reading the winds. That's how I imagine you as a young man. Almost beautiful.
I was absolute in my small dominion as any potentate on earth. I crafted legislation.
Striding up and down the deck, thundering your orders with a grace and purpose of a Greek god. Not an old man, shrinking in his silks and laces.
She was carrying the box. If it had spread, I'd have lost the rest, as it were. I only lost 21.
Butcher.
I was responsible for her death, yes. But let's come at it from a different angle. Allow us to negotiate it. I have been further educated since then, and it's only in retrospect that I can say that I would not do the same today. But that day, your aunt was classified as cargo. I threw cargo overboard.
My mother grieved for her sister all her short life. Grief. An affliction so formidable it can take generations to
speak splendidly. You've evidently received a first-class education. Have you considered the fact that you'd not have had such fine refinements had you been born wriggling in the mud off the bite of Benny?
Executioner! Assassin! Cutthroat!
Why look at things with such a pestiferous air? Within this delicately nurtured wrath of yours, might you be able to conceive of the notion that now I am truly regretful?
If there is a heaven, and I have come to believe from the continuous hints and murmurs of this world that there is, I pray you are already in it.
And yet I enjoy my pipe. I reread the classics, and I am enriched. I admit I've made mistakes, but that does not mean I cannot enjoy, deeply enjoy, the sight of a fork-tailed flycatcher eating peanuts from a string I've hung in the garden.
Ever since I was 5 years old, and my uncle told me her story, I have been with my aunt. I sleep under water, tied to that same chair, sinking in the dark. Have you ever tried to breathe underwater? The trick is not to resist the water pushing to get in. Once your lungs fill, you relax. And that's when you gather up to pull up from the bonds, and sometimes, on a good night, we rise to the surface. What is inside you? A model of classical compositions, harmony in all its parts.
So deliciously smug in your condemnation for me, aren't you? You may return to heaven.
London.
Ah. I thought I heard as much by your accent. You may go back to that damp city, leaving me to burn in my perdition. But are you sure? I have lived in your mind for decades. You have always been here, always will be here with me. Am I wrong? The thought of me is so familiar, I'm like family to you now. And why not? The facts are that it was I, Captain James DeWolf, who was at your aunt's side those last minutes before she drowned. As I tied the mask to her face, I felt her breath on my hands. Her mouth was hot with fever when I stuffed the rag to keep her quiet. Her bare arm touched me and mine as I worked to secure the ropes. Our breathing came as one as I began to lower her hand over hand toward the water. You understand what I'm saying? In those last moments, I possessed her entirely.
Not entirely, no. To you, Captain, my aunt was merely one of the 10,000 of the millions whose names you never knew. But she had a name.
Let's see, I can give you what I want. I am a shrewd one with exchange.
I don't think I've ever encountered a man who is so uninhabited within as you are. What I am looking at now is not a former senator, privateer, or slaving captain, but a lonely, old sack of skin, putrid with self-pity and entitlement. You're not large enough to be my tyrant.
Wait! Come back here! How dare you! As a young man, I was the toast of this city! Even men found me handsome. At the ball, women would be so excited in my presence that they'd leave behind small, wet patches when they rose from their seats.
By the way, I prefer Poussin's earlier version of the Arcadian Shepherd, in which the figures have a sense of movement, drive, hunger for knowledge, spontaneity. This one is lifeless. Senator, you borrowed the wrong version.
Tell me her name! Do you hear me?
Okay, after those performances, let's open the panel discussion. could I begin with you, Robin, and each person? Well, I'm just really going to go from my left down, which also gives LisaGay time to compose herself. Each panelist will have about 5 to 7 minutes or so. And then we hopefully have a conversation. So, Robin, Professor Kelley.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Is this on? Can you hear me now?
No.
Okay. Mic's on.
Check, Tony.
Yeah. This one's hide if you want to use this.
Okay, we use this pass now. Okay, well, I didn't know I was gonna give 5 to 7 minutes. I won't take that much time. Okay, so this play is quite extraordinary. You're saying, well, why am I sitting here? Well, besides the fact that LisaGay and I share children and a house and a life together, Naomi Wallace, when she conceived of the idea, had shared this, the play, an early draft of it, which is based on Marcus Rediker's book. And it was one of the most extraordinary things I'd read on the transatlantic slave trade. One of the myths about the play, and I just want to put this out there just to clarify, is that, you know, because she's dealing with the range of violence in the slave trade, the violence directed at enslaved people, of course, the crew, the complete, you know, domination of this sort of exploitative system, that somehow there's equivalency, that somehow the violence against the crew is similar to the violence against the slave, and that's not true at all. It centers on what it means for international commerce to attempt to turn Africans into commodities. The story of Adjoa and the story of Dembe show that that actually fails. You know, capital's generated, wealth is generated, but they never become commodities. And in some respects, the play is, you know, is told from the perspective of the enslaved, and Bristol's character in some ways is that the ghost that haunts coming back for revenge. And I think, you know, one of the amazing things, and LisaGay could talk about this, about her character, which to me is very important, is that the fact that she realizes that she doesn't have to take him out. That in some ways, what's so central in kind of the traditions of Black struggles for freedom is that revenge isn't the thing that drives those movements, but rather justice. And that, you know, in some respects, justice was still, you know, in the future, but at the end of the play, what you don't see is that she ends up making, reconnecting with Demby, and Demby, we discover, is actually not only helping old sailors make the transition to a resting place, but secretly, Demby is part of the Underground Railroad, helping, you know, fugitives run away and find freedom. And so she ends up leaving England, settling in with Demby, and basically working on abolition and on the Underground Railroad. So the ending is actually one that shows the continuation of the struggle for freedom and the continuation struggle for justice. And so I think it's a very, very powerful play in that respect. I know there's a lot more to be said. I'll say that. I just also say that LisaGay's performance in the play is just absolutely extraordinary. And if you haven't seen it, you know. And with that, I'll pass on to Marcus.
Okay, I want to thank Jordan for organizing this event. I want to thank Tony for hosting it. I want to say what an honor it is to be with the people here on the stage, or at least we were on the stage a moment ago. And I want to say to Naomi, who is watching in Yorkshire, we love you, Naomi.
Yes.
And we wish you and your big heart were here with us. I had the first glimmer of this play about 8.5 years ago. I had sent Naomi a copy of The Slave Ship, and she wrote back to me about the woman in the chair. And she said, Marcus, as long as we tell that woman's story, she will never die. In my mind's eye, she said, I see her rising up out of the water again and again and again. She is not yet, she is not ever drowned. Now that's beautiful. That's poetry. That's the real meaning of history from below, in which we try to recover lives of struggle and take meaning from them and learn from them for our own present and future. About 6 months later, I got a message from Naomi who gave me very good news. She said that she had just been commissioned to write a play by the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. It had to be on some aspect of American history, but it was really up to her. So she says, what should I do? I said, Naomi, write a play about the woman in the chair. And so we went back and forth about this, and she considered a lot of different options, and she finally decided to do it. So the next part of our correspondence and discussion was Naomi taking the measure of the great moral magnitude of what she had decided to do. Now, if you're going to write about the slave trade or about slavery, this comes with great moral responsibility. Naomi understood this. She said things to me like, what if I can't do it? I said, you can do it. She says, there are so many ways to get it wrong. I said, there are many ways to get it wrong. I guess I wasn't too comforting on that. She said, but I've got to get it right. And what she meant by that was, I have to get the history right. Naomi has such powerful respect for the history, and there's a very clear reason why. If you don't know the real history, you don't know what people went through in the slave trade. So this was something that she dedicated herself to doing, taking on this daunting task, to making it real, and to understanding how the slave trade actually worked. That then took her to the question of power. Who had it? How did they use it? How did people resist power? How did that work? And she focused in on the issue of naming. Naming as an act of power. A big part, as I'm sure all of you know, of the Atlantic slave trade, a big part of its violence was the systematic effort to destroy the identities of the African peoples on board those ships. And renaming is a big part of that. That's just part of the violence. So Naomi soon writes to me and she says, with great urgency, she says, Marcus, what is the woman's name? What is her name? Now this was not a naive question. She knew that the woman was nameless in the documents, but she was setting a task for us. So I said, let me see what I can learn. So I went back to all the documents that I had about slaving voyages out of the Gold Coast, present-day Ghana. And I found what I expected, that on those voyages, the way the slave ship captains referred to the women was by a number. Woman number 13 died. Woman number 37 gave birth to a pickaninny. Woman number 73 has a fever. But I found one document out of the Gold Coast in which a ship's physician wrote down the name of a woman as he was treating her. And I sent this to Naomi, the document. We talked about it. Naomi said, that's a beautiful name. That's going to be her name. That's the way I'm going to think about her. That's the way we're going to talk about her. Now, I'm not going to tell you what the name is because James DeWolf is here, right? But what I want you to notice is that Naomi was humanizing the story. She was creating this person as a real person with a name and a history and hopes and dreams. Robin writes about freedom dreams. This play is about freedom dreams. Another very important thing that Naomi said, and this is going to be my challenge to you, to all of us. Naomi said, now she note that she has written this play around an act of terror. She says, this murder belongs to us. It's ours. This murder is part of our history. What are we going to do with it? Well, you see what she did with it. She turned it into art, and a very political kind of art. But what she's asking us through this play is, do we have the courage to face the dark pages of our history? Every day we talk about terror. It's on the front page of every newspaper. It's often the lead story on the nightly news. The big question is, can we talk about the terror that was instrumental to building this country? Because that, folks, is what the slave trade was. All about terror, violence, and control. So I see the liquid plain as a really brilliant contribution to a national and international debate that is going on but hasn't really happened yet, primarily because so many people are afraid of it. And I thank Naomi Wallace for this magnificent challenge.
I think the first thing I want to say is that I was one of the lucky people to see this play staged in New York, and to just thank LisaGay Hamilton again for her performance then and tonight. It was mesmerizing, horrifying, and stunning to sit and watch this history unfold before my eyes. So I too am very grateful that this play exists. A lot of what I would like to have said has been covered, and that is good, and as it should be. I think a couple of other things I would add is what it meant and means to me that this is a play about a woman, as a black woman. The history of slavery, as I first encountered it earlier in my life, was a very, very masculine history. Women were captive and enslaved at lower rates from Africa, and they were not known to be the leaders of the insurrections. They were not the figures who were at the forefront. This play, putting not one, not two, but three women who experienced slavery at its center, at its core, makes it an artistic representation of slavery that is all the more necessary and all the more powerful to me.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. So first, let me just say that I'm really honored and feel unnecessary to be on this panel in some ways, because I really think that, you know, this is the finest group of artists, of scholar activists, of intellectuals we could have assembled. So really, thank you all for coming. It's really, really a pleasure to have you here. And to Naomi Wallace as well, I know she really wanted to be here today, and we would have loved to have her. But since she can't be here, what I want to do is just take a few moments to situate what I think is the importance of the Liquid Plain and of Wallace's work. I'll do it in like 5 minutes, 4 minutes. In the context of the history and the future of freedom struggles, so let me kind of jump right into it. In a conversation about the politics and poetics of her plays, Naomi Wallace once observed that we're often taught the common sense notion that there's, quote, always been rich and poor, that there's always been corruption, that they say that about everything, about racism, about sexism, about homophobia. Yet she explained by contrast that her work intends to show that, quote, it is human nature to resist oppression. And then in the end, all change comes from dreaming, from folks sitting down and dreaming what they want different. In this way, she depicts the, quote, power of the imagination to create a different world in a community's mind. And it is magical to be able to sustain that dream, end quote. Liquid Plain, as Marcus already pointed out, helps sustain freedom dreams in the context of what I believe is the most significant crisis of racism, of prisons, policing, and permanent war that we've seen in decades. Inspired specifically by the epilogue of Marcus's book, The Slave Ship, and takes the story of violence and torture of slavery as central in the making of global capitalism. In this way, both Rediker and Wallace represent what W.E.B. Du Bois said in his magnum opus, Black Reconstruction, was the most magnificent drama in the last 1,000 years of human history. And I think that's what we saw today is one act in that magnificent drama, and suggests why we have to grapple with, as Evie pointed out in her epilogue, the slave ship as a prison, factory, and war machine, as the slave ship puts it so eloquently. Wallace's representation of this historical drama is, as she observes, an act of transgression. I continue to believe, Wallace writes, that envisioning a different world is what makes us half divine. To live in and write in a world of resistance to injustice is what makes our lives worthwhile. And the resistance in the liquid plain comes in the form of what Robin calls the poetry of social movements in his book, Freedom Dreams. After all, the title of The Liquid Plain comes from Phyllis Wheatley's 1773 poem, A Farewell to America. While the Britannia's distant shore, I'm quoting now, we sweep the liquid plain and with astonished eyes explore the wide extended main. Set on the docks of Bristol, Rhode Island, it is a story of freedom dreaming and fugitivity and in the 1790s and in the 1830s when LisaGay Hamilton's character, Bristol, comes to avenge the murder of her mother by the slaver, James DeWolf, the richest man in Rhode Island and the region due to his accumulation of capital in the slave trade. Bristol's intervention is to confront DeWolf in his mansion, Linden Place, which we've just seen brilliantly performed. And when he confronts, as you just saw, he boasts of financing 88 voyages, enslaving over 10,000 Africans, and owning 3 plantations in Cuba, and thus highlights the centrality of slave labor and the accumulation of capital in Rhode Island, the region, and the U.S. empire as a whole. Politics is history, Wallace reflects, and history is what sparks my imagination. That's where my fire comes from. This history of slavery should spark our political imaginations about the pervasive persistence of violence, torture, and racism. And to paraphrase Marcus, not only in the rise of global capitalism, but in its persistence in the present. Now, while the poetry of social movements is rarely considered in debates about political alternatives, the significance of the liquid plain in this regard cannot be overstated. A century and a half after the Civil War and Reconstruction, 50 years since the formal abolition of Jim Crow, the project of abolition democracy, first identified by Dr. Du Bois in the 1930s, has not yet been completed. Contesting the dominance of racism, of mass incarceration, and of permanent war represents an opportunity to complete its unfinished business. I think that by drawing on the collective memory of abolition, the liquid plain articulates the moral economy and social visions of an aggrieved and insurgent people, and that by analyzing these anti-racist freedom dreams of the past, we can better understand democratic struggles for social change in the present, sparking the possibility for abolitionist futures. And I'm quoting Wallace, "Let us transgress together, and by this heat, by the sparks that are generated, make a light to see by for all of us." Thank you.
What am I supposed to talk about? Seriously. Well, I have to say, it's a real luxury as an actor to be able to revisit material. You know, you do a play, you do a movie, and that's it, it's put away. But it's actually really wonderful to revisit it. And Naomi, after Marcus's explanation of the name, we should redo the scene again, because that really, and Robin spoke about it, but sometimes it just doesn't hit you. And it just hit me as you spoke about it. And should be played completely differently. So erase whatever you saw. That didn't really work. Because that's the dynamic of that. The advantages of sleeping with a historian. One of the advantages is that no matter what play you do, and no matter what television series you do or whatever I do, there's always a historical perspective to it, which is fabulous for me. Because I really am able to locate the truth, even though they're not my words, but they do become my words. And the question is, how can I bring truth to that material when in fact, and not in this instance, obviously, but so often when the writer absolutely has no idea what the truth is. None. Zero. Zero. So what's extraordinary about working with someone like Naomi is that it's here. You know, the truth is here. And so the freedom to dig deeper is more efficient because I don't have to wade through BS. So I just am able to go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And then just from an inside perspective, anytime, and even in your own lives, when you're working in your church group or you're working with students, or it's those individuals who get together to collaborate, and there's so many different personalities and backgrounds and political thoughts and beliefs. And in this rehearsal process for the play in New York, it was really interesting to have so many different kinds of viewpoints. And one of our actors said, "It really is still that bad, isn't it?" Right? So just go, "Where have you been? Where have you been?" So it was wonderful from an educational standpoint, but also wonderful from a collaborative standpoint to see how far we actually have not come. And I'm going to tell the secret of the play, because should I not? Don't.
No, I guess you should. I try to avoid it in the introduction.
Okay.
But you should go ahead.
Well, okay, let's put it this way. What Naomi, I think, did in particular with Marcus's book, as he suggests, she brings it into an artistic perspective. And what Naomi typically tries to do is not leave anybody out, right? She really, really tries hard to not leave anybody out. And that includes religion, that includes sexual preference, your gender orientation. And what's wonderful about this play is that she does just that. She brings the community, the real world, to the play. And if you ever have an opportunity to see the production or have an opportunity to read it, I have to say, when I read it, my mouth was on the floor. So I really recommend you getting the book, the play, because as a read, forget a production, because they may not be very good, but a read is, it's just a phenomenal read. And when I read it, I was like, "Holy Robin, holy Toledo, I want to play all three roles. Can I try to do all three?" I actually lobbied for that. but just a real pleasure to revisit it. And I want to say, if Jeff is out there anywhere, thank you to Jeff. We just met today, and we just jumped in this morning. And that's also really a wonderful experience to meet someone for the first time. And you say, "Okay, let's just start." And you just create, so you're so easy to work with. So thank you very much. And wonderful. OK, I'm sure that was 5 minutes. I'm sure that was 5 minutes.
We have a few more minutes. Can we open up to the audience, to you all, questions, comments?
Yeah.
This mic.
I was struck with your commentary about advocacy, scholarly advocacy. And what I've noticed is that the conversation about racism in America has not happened, in my view. Texas has a textbook, excuse me, that describes slavery as migrant labor. Texas has a this does it, doesn't it? Texas has a textbook which describes slavery as migrant labor. There is a county in Alabama where 75% of the kids are in poverty. The life expectancy is 52 years, and those are almost all black people. And because of the gerrymandering of politics in the South, there is no right to vote because the districts have been reconfigured. The people don't have a chance to actually vote. So you add on top of that the suppression of vote that's been going on across the South. And you say to yourself, OK, when are we going to have this conversation? What role do you all have to move this elite talk to places much lower on the totem pole, to the school boards across the country, to the places that really will make a difference? That's my question.
Okay, so I know other people will respond to this, and since I didn't say much at the beginning, I will say, I have to say that there is a conversation on race, and that conversation actually produced that textbook. And this is the problem. I mean, the problem is, because I totally agree with what you're saying, that at that level, at every level, the conversation has been about erasure. It has been about trying to tell a story that somehow America has transcended racism, and that slavery was just a kind of anachronism, and that, you know, even the idea that when the right wing swept Congress and they were reading the Constitution and made a deliberate choice to exclude the parts of the original Constitution that basically didn't just underwrite slavery, but identified congressional representation in terms of 3 out of 5 enslaved people being counted so that states in the South could have more power. The fact that they took all that stuff out suggests that that is a conversation. It's actual erasure, actual revision. And so part of what a play like The Liquid Plain tries to do is to enter that conversation in dissent. And it's there, but the question is, even if we talk and talk and talk, unless we can actually see that the story is tied to who tells the story is tied to who has power, you know? Who tells the story is also tied to who is recognized as full, realized citizens, you know, human beings, then we're going to continue to sort of say, let's have a conversation, and when we're going to start that conversation, it really is about pushing back in a certain kind of way. So I know other people have something to say about that. I know there's no shortage of textbooks and scholarship and other things. I mean, Earl Lewis and I both published a textbook for secondary schools. It wasn't adopted, you know. So the question of who gets to adopt these things have nothing to do with scholarship. It has everything to do with school boards. And in an age where school boards are being replaced, right, by mayors making decisions or emergency managers or running cities, then we don't have a future of being able to have the conversation and be able to intervene with the dissent that's about the truth, you know.
Yeah, I would simply add that I agree the conversation is going on. We'll have a real discussion about race when we have a movement from below big enough to force it. Now, we made progress, some progress, because of the civil rights and black power movements, who demanded a new kind of history that took race and slavery seriously. And I think we probably went a third of the way. But then there was all this reaction and denial and local school boards reading this and that out of the record. There's a tremendous gap between what is known about the history of slavery, what can be known, what has been studied, and what the public actually knows. But let's be honest about one thing. We're not having this discussion because a lot of people don't want to have it. Mm-hmm. They are afraid of it. So let's just admit that. But this is it's really a question of a movement.
Go ahead. Another question. I would just add that the play actually stages this question of knowledge. There are things that Bristol does not know about her mother and father that allow us in the audience at once to see her struggling with a lack of knowledge, and to be able to reflect on what we have to do about the gaps and the absences, and also to think about how we go about finding some of those answers, insisting on those answers as the character does in the play. So that question of historical knowledge is central to what the play does.
I think I saw someone on the side. So I have one very quick comment to make and then a question. The comment is, I think I may have missed this, but I just want to make sure that it's noted that the DeWolf family in Bristol actually did have an enslaved child whose name was Ajua. And the DeWolf children, through all the generations, including the present one, have learned a nursery rhyme in which they speak her name, and they still use that nursery rhyme in their family. So I just wanted to add that because it's a curious twist on the whole thing about name. But my question is really to the two women. And what I wanted to ask you about, if you could speak about this, because I know when you either write about slavery or you perform something to do with slavery, I know that you sometimes have to revisit the trauma and the terror, and it's not like getting up and doing something about anything, but it's very specific. So if you could talk maybe just briefly about what it takes from you as Black women to write or perform in slavery for Black women.
Well, I think you may get more of the answer that you're interested in from LisaGay. So I will go quickly and say, in terms of my own writing, I actually take a path that's different from the one that Naomi takes in writing a play. She doesn't have the luxury of not creating characters and giving them voice and embodying them to the extent that she needs to get their words onto paper. As a poet, I have a wider range of tools, and I actually tend not to try to give voice to those figures whose subjectivity, whose experience I don't feel equipped to know. And I don't say that as a criticism. I'm really glad that poems and plays and things that do the first person voice of the enslaved exist. But as a writer myself, I don't have an answer to that question. I go into the history and I find that hard enough, but I don't embody or inhabit, in a sense, out of a kind of respect for what I don't know.
I like to work. So, however, I like to work on certain kinds of material. So, I have been just about every slave and raped by every master you could possibly imagine. And I don't, it's not the specific experience that wears me out, it's the work that wears me out. So it's interesting, there's this discussion, I guess, about trauma and the political movements that are going on campuses now, and whether or not one can read a piece of material or see a movie because of the trauma that it causes. Boo! If I don't deal with the material, if I don't deal with truth, then what's the point, I think? And I kind of don't understand that psyche, so I love truth. I love being able to try to express it and share it and give it and talk about it. So, I mean, I have had experiences on sets where it's not like the ancestors came to me or anything like that, but it was just like deep. It was just like deep, you know. Or someone said something and you just went, "Oh shit," or. I'm in a scene and I've just been, you know, sold to the master, and I'm in a wagon. And for some reason, it just like, just went right through me. It's like, oh, yeah, okay. So but just the same as I could be playing any other sort of character, and that truth of that character and the experience that she has, I'm lucky if I can get to that place, lucky enough as an artist, you know, you're only but so successful at it at any given time. And
it's really wonderful when I can hit it. But I would say I don't really know what that fear is like. I don't think a really good friend of mine, Bea Richards, and I was doing a play, and she was trying to talk to me about it, and she said, just think of the fear. In that performance, just think of the fear alone of what it is for a woman, for an enslaved person, to just get up in the morning and get through the day. The fear of being taken advantage of being beat, of being raped, of being just the day. Just the day. So I have to say, I can't imagine what Palestinian children go through. I can't imagine. And the horror. And this, what does that do to your body and your mind and the history and when you grow up? And I couldn't, so documentaries are really good. They're better than anything ever, right? So I don't know if that answered the question.
Is there someone inside?
There's a bunch of people.
Okay.
Can you point to them?
Yeah. Blue shirt, and then there's somebody on the other side. Right here, and then there. Right.
I wanted to, and there. It's not much of a question, it's a statement. I want to thank you for this. I lecture on how to talk about slavery in 2016. And when I talk all the facts, including about the dwarfs and the like, it goes over. But nothing is as powerful as story. So halfway through, I stop and I tell three stories. And I talk about the Sally, because it's one of the most brutal slave ship voyages in the history of America. And I just want to thank you, because again, story is powerful. And both of you brought story to us. So again, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. I thought people might be interested to know that the modern-day descendants of DeWolf did try to kind of uncover their own family history.
Could you speak a little louder for me, please? Thank you.
I'm sorry, should I try again? Okay. Thought people might be interested to know that the modern-day descendants of the DeWolfs tried to deal with their own family history and kind of understand what it meant to inherit that kind of privilege and wealth, and that there's both a film and a book that's based on their experience. And I think one of the things I took from this was how much the slave trade is kind of popularly understood as being, slavery is popularly understood as being a southern phenomenon, and instead of an economic system in which every region was complicit and people who did not themselves have slave ships were complicit. One of the characters goes through that really beautifully in the play.
Okay, great, thank you. There, and then Jordan.
Thank you so very much. Slavery and justice seems like something we are hearing about more recently. And it makes me wonder, when you say that we don't have the courage to deal with it, it feels like this open wound, this sore, this something that we've never, ever dealt with. The plane goes down and you don't ever get to recover your family. So you never get that closure. Do you think the dialogue is coming closer? I think of the article in the New York Times recently about Georgetown having to deal with the descendants or the slaves when they sold some of that property on all of their slaves. They think that, I don't remember how many millions of dollars that it's worth. Do you think, and they know exactly who those slaves were, I think they found the descendants, something like 1,200 people. Do you think we're at a time now, and they're really grappling with this issue of, what is justice? Is sorry enough? Do they owe them something? The institution stands on that. The future continues on the, we talk about standing on the shoulders, but really America stands on the backs of many people. So I wonder where we are, if we are getting to a place where we're going to get justice and some closure. And I think I watch closely what's happening at Georgetown right now.
Okay.
A very quick answer is that it's interesting that it feels like we're getting closer and it feels like this is on the agenda in a certain kind of way. And then you could read the Pittsburgh Courier in the 1940s and see, or you can even see the fact that the demand for reparations goes back like to the 1850s. And that the reparations is one way to try to, of course, it could never bring closure, but one way to sort of begin to think about the wealth generated, the lives lost, and the fact that much of what we think of as a privileged white America benefited, even those who may not have been in the United States or in the Western Hemisphere in the 19th century or 18th century. So there's more and more scholarship, more and more evidence, more and more discussion, but it's a long discussion that's been going on for a very, very long time. And I don't know if we'll ever bring closure. And maybe closure is not so much the issue. Reparations in some form or fashion, not as a way to close off the conversation, but to begin to think about it, is, I think, a very important part of that. And the work that they're doing here at the center, I think, is very important.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And just to respond to another point that's been made, it seems to me that the Center for Slavery and Justice should stage Naomi's play. let's put that on the agenda for the future, and let's make that happen, because we've had a great discussion of it. Let's have the play.
No, thanks, Marcos, and it actually is on my list. but I would just say very quickly around the questions of justice that we might want to think about that the question of justice is not necessarily about a kind of reparation for a past, but also is about what happens in the present. So that if one is thinking through justice, reparations is really very, not easy, but it's very important. But what are the ways in which that past has structured our lives today that creates forms of injustice that we need to pay attention to? And so that there's a way in which, Professor Rose talks about questions of structural racism. There's a way in which I think we always have to, we think about justice with a kind of backward glance as to, okay, what can we, how can we give these slaves justice? And I'm for that, absolutely. But I'm also saying that perhaps one of the best ways you can give those slaves justice is to make sure that their descendants have a good health care, proper schooling, et cetera, and do not have to face racism.
I enjoyed the discussion and the play. One of the points that come across my mind, you have a lot of millionaires, and with a lot of the millionaires and billionaires, they're minorities. And I think this discussion should be brought to the people that have money, because money is power, with all institutions, their donations to keep things going. And I think there should be either a fund or a philanthropist or a group that should approach this problem, because it is a problem. It's miseducation. So long as you have miseducation, black history is a part of American history, slavery is a part of American history, Indians are a part of American history, and you don't know this until you become an adult, and then you see how this trickle-down effect affects you in life. So the people that have the money, that are making music, that have the power, these are the people that should be approached to make changes, to get it into the school system, so it can be an overall education to the descendants that are coming up.
Okay. Is there any, I mean, it's a statement, I think, which is worthwhile thinking about. I'm just trying, we're going to try and take one more question.
Yes, I work in K-12 education on Africa. And also, I'm the chair of a committee called Hidden Brookline on the hidden history of slavery and freedom in the town of Brookline, Massachusetts. And what we're beginning to uncover is the importance, and this is following from the previous comment, the importance of elementary education for elementary students. I don't mean basic education. Because young children are able to begin to talk about and learn about slavery. And this is what we found with working with third grade students across the town in a way that adults find very uncomfortable. So we need a whole lot more in elementary education. The state of Massachusetts says that all elementary third graders must study colonial Massachusetts. And they say that there were only two groups in colonial Massachusetts, Native Americans and whites, which is a historical falsehood. And we're also finding that there has been no increase in the number of African-American authors for elementary children in the last 10 years, I think it's true. So there is a lot we need to do at the pre-college, even the pre-high school level, when minds are more open and children are less afraid and are more open to learning. So I particularly encourage anyone here to think more about that, because children are our future, and they have minds that are open in ways that adults often aren't. Thank you.
Thanks for that statement. Well, the last person, so that otherwise, because people have been here since morning setting up for plays they need, and they have to set up early in the next tomorrow morning.
Thank you. I wanted to say, I actually graduated from this room 25 years ago, and it's so powerful to come back here and to hear a panel like this, and to follow up from on a question from someone I was talking to. I'm a teacher, and I feel like we were talking out there. And I think while we're waiting for schools to change and mayors to do things and everything to happen, probably the majority of people in this room have that conversation going. And when you talk about children's books, buying books as gifts, and all those small acts that we do that make that change daily, it's just that's where the power is, and that we can control while we're waiting for that bigger change. So thank you so much. All right.
Very, very quickly. I appreciate the last two comments very much, so I want to return back to the play, because one of the things the play does is it shows the connection between slavery and wealth accumulation and slavery and politics. One of the mistakes that we've made in multicultural education is that we've treated groups as individual silos alongside each other. I think we make a mistake by saying, well, we have to have Black people represented, we have to have Native Americans represented, Asians represented, and white people represented, when actually it's a relationship between capital, labor, and wealth that the play reveals, and that once you see that, you'll see that it's not just about inserting people, but rethinking the whole creation of the United States of America. I got people who think the three-fifths compromise is about Black people being three-fifths of a human being. And they totally miss the fact that it's about political power. Mm-hmm. They don't know that, though. Students come away not knowing that, because they're not being taught that. So I think we have to really think about how we teach to make something that goes beyond multicultural education to something much deeper.
All right. Thank you very much, Robin. Could I begin my closing remarks by asking you all please to give all the performers a standing ovation, including Jeff. Thank you very much, and thank you very especially, Jeff, for coming in such late. Let me thank Rights and Reason Theatre for agreeing to host this this performance and program here, and I would like to thank the staff of the Rights and Reason Theatre, thank Alonzo, who does all the lights and has been doing this for many years, somewhere, and the tables and so on. Kathy Moyer, who we worked with very closely to make this happen. Kathy is somewhere around. Jordan, who is our intern at the center, who's somewhere there with the mic. Ariel, who works, who's also at the center as a fellow, who works. I would like to invite all of you over to the center for reception and also to view the exhibition Black Shackle, which is an exhibition about African Americans in the coal mining industry in Appalachia, something that not many people know about, but is, again, what we try to do at the center is actually to take hidden history and to bring it to the fore. And then I have to make a comment, which I promised my board and the center that I'll make, and I have to do it shamelessly. The Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice is 3-4 years old to do the work that we want to do. Holding symposiums like this, bringing performances like this, bringing Naomi Wallace's play, if we can do it, into the center. Running a set of programs, which we are now trying to do, digital history on slavery for the schools in Rhode Island. Running a port markets project where we can identify where all the ships have come into the state. Trying to do research clusters on questions of race, on medicine, education, the carceral state. Trying to do research clusters and work about the relationship in New England between the indigenous Native Americans and the African Americans, because that is a very important story nationally, but also very important, super important, if you wish, in this part of the world, in this part of the United States. Trying to do all of that requires us to have money. The university gives us money, but to do the programs that we want to do and at the level that we want to do, we have to fundraise. And therefore, one of the things that we have developed, and I'm really being shameless about this, because without that, you can't have this. I've learned that as a director, right? So then this doesn't run on good faith, right? But one of the things that we have done is that we have formed something called Friends of the Center. And when you go outside, there are forms to fill in. I'm asking you gently, please, if you would consider signing up and becoming a friend. And when you sign up, we'll be in touch with you as to how not only can contribute financially, but how can you participate in the center. We are a place in which ideas, you can come to us with ideas, and once we can do them, we will do them. So I want to thank you all very, very much for this. I want to thank the panelists, and particularly the performers, to do this. And I want to invite you all, I want to invite you over to the center. Finally, I would like to thank Naomi Wallace for doing this play and for making it possible for us to do this performance and have that rich discussion which we just had. Thank you very much, Naomi.